Following is a presentation of Relentless Podcast Network. From its headquarters in beautiful Moline, Illinois, the home of strong opinions and emotional analysis of your Chicago Cubs, IVMV.com proudly presents the IVMV Podcast.
Hello and welcome to the IVMV Podcast, which is part of Relentless Podcast Network. It's Tuesday, December 11th, 2012. I am one of your co-hosts. My name is Corey, and there are two other guys joining me through the internet tonight.
Hey, it's Andy.
This is Kurt.
I feel kind of weird when I see you guys are joining me through the internet. I haven't figured out joining me remotely tonight. I don't know.
Through the internet's pretty good.
Yeah, it just sounds too like 1998.
Yeah, we all dialed in.
Our site is IVMV.com, and we have blog posts about the Cubs from our writers there. And we are broadcasting this recording live. In the off-season, we do these on Tuesday evenings at 8:30 p.m. Central. And you can go to IVMV.com/live to watch and listen as we do this. And there's also a chat there so you can chime in on what we're discussing. Well, the Cubs have added some new players in the last week, and we're going to talk about those guys tonight. First off, the Cubs signed Fujikawa, and he is a free agent closer from Japan. And you guys know how to say his first name? Is it Kaiyuji?
Sounds about right.
Yeah. Do you guys know what Kaiyuji means? I'm sure.
No, are you?
Some of the listeners know. It literally means baseball kid.
No way.
Yes. Yeah. So.
Did you use Google Translator for that?
No, it was in his Wikipedia page.
Oh, okay.
Fujikawa, he's 32 years old, and he spent his 12-year professional career with the Hanshin Tigers in Japan. So that means he was a teammate of former Cub Matt Merton. And on paper, Fujikawa's stats are pretty good in the last five seasons. He has an average of 31 saves per season. He has an ERA of 1.33. And he was the first reliever in Japanese baseball to have three straight 100 strikeout seasons. He has three or four pitches. His best pitch is a fastball that reportedly has a hop to it, and it's a kind of late movement on his pitches. And he also throws a forkball and a curve. We've established in the last episode that I am not an expert in many things. You can add Japanese baseball to that list.
Come on.
But I do know that dominance in Japanese baseball doesn't necessarily equate to success in the major leagues. And apparently, he said that facing better quality hitters is one of the motivations for him coming here to play. So I don't think we can expect him to put up numbers like he did in Japan, but I don't, you know, we can't label him as a failure if he doesn't, I guess. So the Cubs gave him a 2-year, $9 million deal, and he was a closer in Japan, as I said. And we know that Marmol was close to being dealt a month or so ago to the Angels. So what do you guys think this means for Marmol, bringing in a closer?
I think it means that the Cubs are actively trying to trade him. Now, the front office isn't saying that. They're saying they're trying to get the best bullpen possible, and they want to be like seven deep. I can't remember, something like that. So they're saying that they're making it sound like they would like to keep Marmol. But I kind of feel like that they're trying to still get rid of him. And I'm using that failed trade earlier as my basis for that assumption or assertion. Yeah.
Yeah, I would agree. I think he's definitely being brought up a lot at the meetings, and I think they're trying to get rid of him, and he's at very least, he knows now he's not guaranteed anything, and he's going to be either a setup guy, unless he gets his stuff together, he's going to be a setup guy, or he's going to be dealt before that if he even makes it that far.
Well, the Cubs have said that as of right now, Marmol, you know, they expect him to close, that he will be the closer, I guess, if he's on the team.
But that's what they say, this but gives you the option that, you know,
sure.
Once he blows three in a row, you yank him.
Yeah, I mean, I think this this move with Fujikawa, you know, just gives the Cubs some flexibility. He's got the pitches. If he's got three or four good pitches, he can do more than close. And so he can really be kind of plugged into almost any role in the bullpen. But, you know, if he is a closer and the Cubs are able to get rid of Marmol, we're not going to be, I guess by doing that, we're not looking at the Cubs forcing a James Russell type into the closer role. Mm. We actually have a legitimate closer. So I think it's a decent, go ahead.
Sorry, I was just going to say the other thing it kind of does for you is, let's just say Marmol doesn't get traded and is pitches well. I mean, I don't think the Marmol of, 2010 is coming back, but if he pitches well and you get another guy like Fujikawa, I think the goal from a management standpoint is to try to shave innings off the end of the game. So let's say Fujikawa is a good closer, you got Marmol in the eighth inning, and I don't know, Sean Kemp in the seventh, any other guy you can plug in there, you're trying to get your starter to not have to go 7-8 innings. So
right.
You're just going to eat away at the back end of the game. So I think that's kind of, you just build up the bullpen to be able to do that.
And maybe bring some consistency to the later innings instead of the patchwork.
Mm-hmm.
But I was going to say, I think it's a decent situation for the Cubs to be in, because if Marmol sucks, they can just pull him out. You know, they've got somebody to plug right in, and Marmol might suck as early as spring training. So I don't, you know. And I think, too, it's good for Fujikawa, because they can use him in various roles, and I think that can help him adjust to American baseball. You know, I'm not sure how many, like, save situations the Cubs are going to be in this year. So I guess if they keep Marmol, they can bring him out once a week when they have a save situation. And then in the meantime, make sure that, you know, Fujikawa has the opportunities to get comfortable and make adjustments that he needs in maybe like less pressure situations. But when it was 101 games, who cares the closer situation is really.
I don't think the Cubs, back to Marmol, I don't think they're going to give him up for nothing like they might some other guys. So if he does, I don't think if they get the deal they like, they'll keep him for the season and then revisit him if he pitches well the first half, revisit trying to make a deal later.
I think they really need for him to go out there and be the closer and look good, mm-hmm. because his trade value can't be much right now. And he didn't have a terrible season last year. I mean, I tried to block most of 2012 out, so I don't remember specifics, but...
But thinking back to 2012, I mean, this seems like a reaction to 2012. I mean, they had Rafael Dolis as the closer for a while, so they didn't really have any other options, any viable options, once they had to move away from Marmol. So this will be good to have, you know, that option. And it seems like that was their thought process.
Yeah. Kurt, did you have anything else to say about Fujikawa?
Not really, because I don't know anything about him other than what you've already read in stats.
Yeah. Well, I did. You know, I found on the Wikipedia page, it said what his entrance song is when the Hanshin Tigers would call him out, you know, out of the bullpen. And I want to play it for you guys. And just see, you know, what would you think if you're an opposing team's batter and, you know, they go to the closer and you're standing there in the on-deck circle and you're just waiting for him to warm up. I want you guys to tell me, like, what you would be experiencing right there. This is from the band Winford. We'll be right back. I think it's something I've set up wrong with my mixer, so that's probably why it was blasting for you guys. So, you know, if you were in the on-deck circle, would that, you know, fear?
Well, when it first started, I would expect to see Yanni come through the gates. yeah, but then I was thinking, okay, you know, it has kind of a lot of strings and stuff, so indicating that there's some pitching artistry to come.
Is that like hardcore in Japan?
I'm not sure. The band is called Lindbergh, and the name of the song is. And this to me doesn't sound, you know, like I think my favorite, you know, song that a player comes into is, oh my gosh, his name just flew out of my head.
John Axford? You
know, yeah, Axford. He comes out to a new noise from Refused. But this song is called Every Little Thing, Every Precious Thing. but
so every little pitch, every precious pitch.
So yeah, I don't know. I guess if it sounded bad for you guys, you might have to listen back to this episode to hear what it sounded like. But music doesn't play that well over Google Plus for you guys.
No, it's
weird.
Horrible.
Yeah, it sounds pretty terrible.
But I can't imagine the non-horrible version sounded much better.
Just wait till you hear it clearly. It's amazing.
All right. Well, the Cubs have also signed an outfielder, and this could lead to a little bit of rearranging with in the outfield with David DeJesus. So, Andy, tell us about the new Cubs outfielder.
Yeah, the new Cubs outfielder is Nate Schierholtz, who is a longtime Giant. And he began his career in San Francisco in 2007. And he played with them up until 2012, and he played for a little while with the Phillies, but for the most part, Giants. And as you mentioned, he's a right fielder, so it's looking like DeJesus is probably, as it stands right now, probably would move over to center field. Now, there have also been rumors that the Cubs are open to adding more outfielders, so we'll see if anything changes with this. But apparently they signed him to a one-year, $2.25 million contract with a lot of incentives, as seems to be modus operandi for Epstein. But the main thing with Schierholtz is, or one interesting thing I saw with his deal is, apparently he was offered at least one longer contract and more money than the Cubs contract. But it sounds like he just has like a pretty robust hunger to play every day. Mm-hmm. And so he's always been in like kind of a logjam of outfielders type of situation. And I think that's what kind of got him to choose the Cubs is that he does have the opportunity to get those plate appearances that he longs for. And
he's like, on every other team, I'm a number five, but on the Cubs, God damn it, I'm number two.
Yeah, I know. It's kind of depressing at the same time. But at least he's hungry to play, and it sounds like the Cubs are in a position to be able to, you know, make him an everyday player, provided that they don't add another outfielder and provided that Brett Jackson doesn't just rip it up in AAA or even in spring training. So, anyway, like the most plate appearances this guy has had is like, I think 362 in 2011. And I think David DeJesus got over 500 last year. So that kind of gives you an indication of how much he played with the Giants. And, he's a career 270 hitter, and he's another left-handed bat, which I think is interesting. It makes the Cubs lineup pretty left-handed heavy, especially with Ian Stewart possibly coming back. So, and the other thing,
we're not sure. Go ahead.
Sorry, go ahead.
No, go ahead.
The other thing about Schierholtz is he supposedly, according to Kerry Muscat, that he has one of the best throwing arms in the league, and he's supposed to be a good defensive player. So that's awesome. Get the guys who can't hit that well, but they're amazing in the field.
Yeah, just more patchwork. Just tiding us over.
Yeah. He's a former second-round pick, so never quite perhaps lived up to expectations, but he never really has gotten a chance to show what he's got for a full season, so maybe we'll have to endure that this season coming up. I don't know.
And the Rule 5 draft was at the end of last week. The Cubs, of course, like every team, claimed some players and lost some players. So, Kurt, tell us what went down.
Well, let's start with who they picked up. His name is Hector Rondon. Rondon. I don't know if I'm pronouncing that right. From the Indians. He's been in the Indian organization his entire career, and he was drafted 06. So he's been around a little while, but he's had a lot of elbow injury recently. But he was a pretty high prospect for the Indians about 6 years ago, and he worked his way up really fast from rookie ball all the way up to AAA in just a few years, and then just sort of started heading the other direction, and then the injuries have dropped him. He was back to rookie ball again as late as last year, so he's having a lot of injury issues. I guess the word is that he's through those, and I think he's pitching in Venezuela. So I guess the sign is that he's back to healthy. The Cubs must have thought, you know, that he was a pretty viable option because he's going to take a 40-man roster spot. And the way the Rule 5 draft works, if you take a guy, he has to be on your 40-man roster, and you cannot designate him for minor league assignment. The only thing you can do is waive him, and then if he clears waivers, he goes back to his original team. So you get back to the Indians. And there's a lot of layers with the Rule 5 draft and eligibility and things like that. But
is that just for the first year, or is that for a period of time?
It is. I believe it is for 1 year, the first season.
Oh.
Let's see. Yeah, I don't know exactly, but basically the rule is put in place to keep players to keep teams from having too many top prospects in their minor leagues that could potentially be playing in the majors for other teams. So they don't stockpile.
Cubs didn't have any of those.
Well, the funny thing is they lost.
Yeah, I know.
They had four guys selected, which were Michael Burgess, Matt Cerda, three guys, right? Four, my bad. Starling, Peralta, Burgess, Cerda, and Alvito Jimenez.
We were big fans of Michael Burgess when he came over.
Yeah. His gazelle trot.
No, he has the large posterior.
Oh, no, okay, I'm mixing him up with...
You're thinking of Fernando Perez.
Yeah, Perez. But, yeah, so the Cubs lost, and, of course, the Cubs Hoyer spun that to be like, hey, that's a good sign. We've got a lot of depth. Yeah, they lost some guys and picked up one. And it's the Rule 5 draft is a little risky because it's not terribly costly, but it does lock up a 40-man roster spot. So right. I guess for Schierholtz, it's good news because with the Fujikawa, Rondon, and Schierholtz, that pretty much locks up the 40-man roster. So any new players are going to have to be trades or somebody's going to have to be moved or designated. So... the deals become a little bit tougher from this point out. There's not going to be any outright signings.
Yeah. All right. Well, we raced through those topics. We're at our break already, which is good because we try to keep these at a half hour over the off season. So I'm sure the caption contest will slow us down.
Yeah, no doubt.
So that's what we'll be doing when we get back, the caption contest and the Cubs.com. Internet muscle flex of the week. But before we go to break, Christmas shopping season is obviously underway, and you can help support our site by going to ivy.com/Amazon for any of your Amazon purchases. And thanks to everybody that's been buying things to our site. We really appreciate it. Doesn't cost you a penny, and it helps us out a lot. And so, yeah, we do appreciate it. After a break, as I said, we'll do the Cubs.com Internet Muscle Flex of the Week and the caption contest. So we will be right back. We'd like to thank you for listening to the IDN podcast and have tried to make it easy for you to find it. You can listen on our site, www.idnb.com. You can listen and download in iTunes. Or if you have an iPhone or an Android phone, check out apps that allow you to download or stream our episodes. We are on Stitcher, Pocket Casts, TuneIn, and many more. If you do have an iTunes account, you can help us out by going and giving us a rating and review. We appreciate your feedback, and thanks for listening to the IDN Podcast. Well, it's time for the Cubs.com Internet Muscle Flex of the Week, and what we do is we browse Cubs.com, look through the articles, and find a comment that I guess can best be described as an Internet Muscle Flex, and just a Moe's message board, condescending, humorous, whatever, just something that makes you laugh. So, I have a couple here.
I've got one, and mine would fall into the sarcastic category.
I have to apologize, guys. I feel really lethargic tonight. I think it's because it's somewhere around 110 degrees down here. I've already gone through like a huge glass of water, and my fingers weren't working right when I was trying to take us in and out of music there and everything. Could be suffering from heat stroke down here.
Oh. Don't pass out.
I'll have to call Galesburg 911.
So, Andy, do you have one?
No, you know what? I poked around quite a bit. I didn't really see when they grabbed me, so.
All right, well, Kurt, you want to go first or you want me to do my two?
Yeah, mine is short and sweet, so I'll go ahead.
Okay.
Like I said, falling into the sarcastic category, and this is in response to the Fujikawa deal, and this person says, this signing is the type of news that I've been waiting for my entire life as a Cubs fan. So I'm going to assume that's sarcastic. I don't know if it might actually be better if it weren't sarcastic, but hold on.
All right, well, my first one that I have here, I don't remember what article it was on, but it doesn't really matter. And this is kind of that internet muscle flex where they get into an argument with someone else in the comments.
Those are the best kind, in my opinion.
Yeah, so this is, and it starts off, JC, your posts suck. You must be a GM, you're so smart. Talk about don't know jack shit, look in the mirror. So I decided anytime anybody busts out, look in the mirror, it's just, That's an awesome internet muscle flex. My second one was off the article about bringing back
Ian Stewart.
Ian Stewart, yes, thank you.
Your brain is boiling inside.
I know, it's so hot down here. For the listeners, I have a wood-burning stove that I put a lot of logs on there tonight to heat up the house, and I'm sitting about 10 feet from it.
Go piss on it a little bit.
Oh, man.
It'll humidify the house.
All right, so this is from the Ian Stewart article, and it reads, are they nuts? Wait, that is an oxymoron. Of course they are. Stupid move.
as an oxymoron.
Oxymoron.
But I thought you, as an English person, you would like that one, Andy.
That's amazing.
Are they nuts? Wait, that's an oxymoron. So, Andy, is that an oxymoron?
No. No, not at all. Moron is, yeah, it's definitely moronic, but oxymoron, no.
Yeah, I thought that one was good. That one made me giggle. All right, so it is time for our photo caption contest. I got to find the picture here real quick. And what it is Dale Swaim when he was with the Brewers, and he's standing next to Robin Yount in the dugout. And Yount kind of has his hands on his hips and kind of a grisly smile over at Swaim. Swaim looks pretty young there. But
yeah, this must have been a couple of years ago or something.
He doesn't look as weathered. I guess the Cubs 2012 season probably weathered him pretty good.
Yeah. That's, he was fresh-faced. Right before the season this past
year. You know how they do little before and after pictures of presidents? Right. This is like the same thing with the Cubs manager job. 1 year as the Cubs manager is the equivalent of 8 years of presidency.
In the White House.
Yeah.
All right, so that's a photo. Andy, you want to go through these?
Sure. And I should mention, too, before I get started on this, I think I forgot to mention one of the person's names last week, and that was Gail, the second quotation with the Coyotes picture.
Oh,
where it says the Wolves are at the door. In our case, we can't even get them interested, so we have to settle for Coyotes. That was Gail, and I neglected to mention the name for some reason. So sorry to Gail, and thanks for entering the contest. So let's move on to this week. We have our first caption is from James, and it reads, "You ever leave this team, I will shoot your ear off."
Yeah, obviously, in case somebody hasn't been paying attention the last couple weeks, the reason I picked this photo was because Robin Yount and Dale Swaim were involved in a pheasant hunting accident, which resulted in Swaim getting shot in the back of the head.
I did talk to somebody, a friend of mine, this weekend, and they were pretty surprised that anybody could get shot hunting like that. Like, they thought that something else must have been up.
Drinking?
Yeah. Most likely would be my guess. But anyway, the next entry comes from Ryan, a frequent IVMV contributor. His reads, "How about next time we just play racquetball?" We have one from Brian that just reads, "Duck." Rob writes, don't shoot your friends. I think that's a Yo Gabba Gabba reference. That's
it amazing. It is. He knows his target audience.
Yeah,
I would not have picked up on that if you would.
Oh, your son's still a little young for it.
Yeah, he's too young for the Yo Gabba Gabba.
Give him about a year, and then you'll watch it nonstop. So thank you, Rob, for that. The original Yo Gabba Gabba song is "Don't Bite Your Friends," which is one of my favorites. It's a good lesson for kids to learn.
It is. They have to learn it. Bite your enemies, but don't bite your friends.
Yeah. Nick writes, Dale Swaim, "Remember that time you shot me?" Robin, "Hasn't happened yet, Dale." "Damn it, Robin, I'm trying to make a relevant reference in this photo caption contest." Robin, "What's a photo caption contest?" Dale, "Just shut up and squint weirdly into that camera."
I don't know if we've ever had the actual contest referenced in an entry.
Yeah.
Wow, that could be a first.
That's meta.
Yes, it is.
The play within the play there. All right, we have Harrison. He writes, not pictured, wilderness, beer, shotgun, maimed ear, unwounded bird. The next entry is from Benjamin, and it reads, you know, one day I'm going to shoot you for making fun of my name. Joe writes, to think, another inch and I could have been the manager of the worst franchise in history. Adam wrote in, and his caption is, Dale, you know, that mustache really makes you look like a pink walrus. Robin, how dare you, sir? I challenge you to a duel. Pistols, 10 paces, turn and fire. Dale, I've got a shotgun. Robin, that will do. Yes, yes, that will do.
Oh.
Sorry if I mangled that, Adam. We have one from Jeff that reads, I can't hear you. Try my good ear. Oh. Bob from the UK, his caption reads, whoa, Dale, did you just drop a fart? The return of the Ivy Envy fart pun, muscles flexed.
We haven't seen automatic fart jokes in a while.
It's been a while.
Good job, Bob.
It does kind of look like a knowing smile.
Yeah.
Nick writes in again, Dale, man, this team sucks. Just shoot me already. Robin, just wait, Swaim. Just wait. Dale, Robin, did you just maniacally laugh under your breath while fiddling with your mustache? By the way, do you want to be part of my staff when I become a manager someday? I plan on slowly getting the gang back together. And a couple more here. We have one from Michael. It reads, Dale said he jokingly called him Dick Cheney after the shooting incident, but he really meant the dick part. And last entry is from Joe, and it reads, if I ever become a manager of a baseball team, and if I ever get to 100 losses, I give you permission to shoot me in the ear.
Oh, man, there's some good ones in here.
Yeah. I've got my winner chosen.
I think I do, too.
Yeah.
I'm going to lock in my vote.
I have two that I am going between.
What do you think, Kurt?
I'm going with Harrison.
Yep, that's what I had.
So the not pictured one?
Mm-hmm. Not pictured wilderness, beer, shotgun, maimed deer, unwounded bird.
That was one of the two.
Unwounded bird really capped it off for me.
Yeah.
That was one of the two I had picked, so the other one was I can't hear you, try my good ear, but, from Jeff. But yeah, I also like Harrison's entry quite a bit.
Not I also pictured, like, I also like bird. Joe's like unsuccessful assassination attempt to become the manager of the Cubs. I thought that was pretty funny.
Yeah.
All right. Well, the one thing that I have learned from tonight's episode is to not start a huge fire right before we record.
Were you listening to Fun also, your favorite band?
No.
Oh, okay.
F-U-N.
I'm just kidding. That's not Corey's favorite band. If anybody no. doesn't know.
Adele is his favorite.
So. Right. Big fan. All right. Well, I think that's it for this episode. And we will be back next week, next Tuesday at 8:30 p.m. Central. And you can watch and listen live at ivmb.com/live. And thank you for listening. And until next time, go Cubs. Yeah.